environment. The Eastern Shore is one of Nova Scotia's best kept secrets, except for those who live here. We need to protect, preserve, and promote our environment as a key area of strength. We need to take advantage of the opportunities to promote tourism, as well as look for ways to address the most vulnerable aspects of our environment to protect them for future generations. How will you work with local areas to ensure our environment is protected and how we can promote our environment to the rest of the world? Ross.
John. I'd like to just say a few words about the environmental policy in general. In the past 10 years, the Conservative government has dismantled the laws protecting our air, land, and water, and often hiding them in those huge omnibus bills. You've heard of them. But on each occasion that those bills went forward, the Liberals voted with them in regards to that, instead of narrowing it down and having direct debate. And I say shame on both of them for that, just shame. I looked up just before I came in here today online. Do you realize that we have 159 lakes and rivers that are protected? Do you know how many we had before we allowed them to get at it? 2.5 million. Shame, shame, shame. And the Liberals support that, so they're not off the hook in that issue. The provinces are taking the rap. It's being downloaded onto the province. And we know the challenges that our economy has here. It has to be shared. The federal government has a major role. Stop downloading on the province. There's only one taxpayer. The NDP will reverse this trend, without a doubt. We'll work with the province to ensure that we have collaboration and then we take the interest and we talk to the people what's important to you. You live here. We will also take action on climate change. We are the only major party that will end the fossil fuel subsidies and put federal carbon tax, a federal carbon cap on the cap and trade system. We need to make people accountable for their pollution, and we need to put a process in place that helps encourages and reduces the continued climate pollution. I want to talk about fishing. I saw some signs, and I talked to a number of people on the doorsteps about the fish farms. We have to ensure that whatever use that we're going to do in business, that we take environmental impacts and concerns into account. And we have to take how people feel and how they want to live in their community into account. And we have to ensure that when decisions are made, there's that complete collaboration with the community. So maybe you're going to have fish farm, maybe it's to have land-based, I don't know. But it has to be from the community, and we have to take the environment completely into account. I would like to go on and talk about some other things, but she's telling me that our time is up on this issue. I do want to say, though, and I want to reiterate, is that without full participation from the federal government, with the municipal government and the provincial government, we can't move forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
A global marketing firm did a survey and went to Asia and asked Asians what they thought of Canada in a word or two, and the number one response was clean. That's a huge marketing asset that Canada has, and I think maybe as Canadians we have an appreciation for what kind of danger that reputation is in. With open pen salmon farms being a major issue on the Eastern Shore, the Green Party is prepared to absolutely put a moratorium on further expansion of open pens. Salmon farms, they're ecologically devastating. They're poor use of our labor and time and productivity. There's a closed confinement salmon model. I toured a facility in Advocate Harbor where they were farming Arctic char, halibut, and salmon, and it was a totally closed loop system with fish waste being used for fertilizer. The owner was so enthusiastic about the potential success of this model. He said that the sky was the limit as far as expansion of this. Our government has taken the easy way out too many times, trying to create jobs at the expense of the environment and the people of Canada. We shouldn't ask our politicians to create jobs, we should ask them to create systems that work. And right now, the federal government has not created a system for Canada's environment that works. Chief among this, and I touched on it already, was carbon pricing. You know, the Green Party is synonymous with the environment. I'm constantly trying to create the idea that the Green Party is not a one-issue party. We've got an excellent platform across the board. My background's in economics, as I've said. I'm a small business owner. But carbon pricing and our environmental policy is a place where the Green Party particularly shines. Other broken models in the local environmental scene, particularly in Nova Scotia, you know, our forestry model is broken. You know, there's our woods are in sad shape, and we're trying to run an industry on the backs of a depleted forestry industry. We need a new vision for that. The main way to accomplish this is to engage local communities. You know, decisions shouldn't be made with respect to any resource use or environmental issue without talking to the local people first. And that's not just fisheries and forestry, that includes windmills, that includes green technology. We've got to get more engaged with the local populations. That's why, as an MP, I would commit to holding town hall meetings throughout the riding on a twice a year basis, coming to talk to the people to make sure this happens. Elizabeth May is a champion of this. She has told their MPs, she has told the candidates that we must be aware that our primary responsibility is to our constituents. And I think the constituents know what their local environment is better than anyone else, and we've got to listen to them. Last, I know I'm running out of time, but I'd like to call attention to some of the investor-state relations that the federal government has been signing these free trade agreements. Canada has been the subject of many free trade rulings against us to the tune of hundreds of millions, billions of dollars. That's giving away the sovereignty over our environment. Thank you.
Something I've cared about for a very long time. In fact, at the outset of this campaign, during a media interview, I was asked when my first official interest in politics took hold. And it was when I was 7 years old in grade two in my elementary school. I was vice president of the Environment Club. And I know I say this as a joke to some degree, but the fact is I grew up as part of sort of a green generation, and protecting our environment is something that's meant everything to me since the time I was a child. When I look at the Liberal Party's platform, it's extremely progressive and focused on green initiatives, both globally and locally. And I appreciate that the question was locally focused, but I do want to mention that we've committed to attending the Paris Climate Conference this year. We're taking action right away. We're going to be meeting with provinces to try to help promote local initiatives. And we're going to be phasing out fossil fuel subsidies to meet our G20 commitment. There was a lot of attention drawn to protecting our environment in the Ivany Report, which is a wonderful document. It says we need to focus on our environment, but we also have important economic needs. But the two were not mutually exclusive. There is a balance to be struck, and we can absolutely strike that balance. Tourism, I believe, was mentioned in the question. We don't need to look further than the 100 Islands for a great opportunity to bring an ecotourism industry to the Eastern Shore. In addition to that, I want to point out that some of the investments in green infrastructure that form part of the largest investment of its kind in Canada's history are going to not only help build wastewater facilities and promote green technologies that will help improve our communities, but it's also possible that a large chunk of these funds could go to remediating polluted lands, which both clean up our environment and create good-paying jobs. In Pictou County, a very sensitive issue is cleaning up Boat Harbour. This is the precise kind of initiative that I believe the funds made available through the Liberal Party's platform will be able to contribute to prevent end discrimination against our First Nation people, clean up our communities, and create good jobs locally that marry both the environment and the economy to make our home a better place. Thanks very much.
Brett?
So thanks to a lot of the work of our Conservative government, Canada has successfully been securing itself as the world's foremost leader in clean energy production. We've boosted clean energy investments. We believe strongly in protecting our natural heritage, including our parklands. We put a lot of effort into that. On greenhouse gas emissions, under our government, we've decreased emissions by 3%, reversing the trend of the Liberal Party that consistently increased greenhouse gas emissions. And we did this while protecting jobs at the same time, as the economy grew by almost 13%. One thing I can assure you that we will not do, that all the other parties are advocating for, we will not bring in a job-killing carbon tax. We are not going to raise the price of everything. A carbon tax would have such a massive negative impact, particularly on rural Canada. The cost of fuel, the cost of groceries, everything would go incredibly high. And I can assure you the Conservative Party will not bring in a job-killing carbon tax. And we're the only party that you can count on that won't do that. Thank you.
One of the things we did in preparing for this forum was to ask the community to contribute some questions. So I have a couple of questions that came from our community as well. For the past number of weeks, we have watched, along with the rest of the world, the plight of refugees as they make their way across Europe. How many refugees are you willing to accept annually to address this crisis? And how will your party cut through the red tape that seems to be holding up these applications? We'll start with David.
The numbers show that allowing refugees into the country is actually a net positive at the end of the first generation of that refugee's life, and becomes a huge positive for Canada in the second generation of the refugee's family. Now, this is something rural Atlantic Canada is somewhat underpopulated at the moment. Canada overall can use more workers to power our ideas and to build businesses. And immigrants are a great source of bringing in new entrepreneurial vigor. Elizabeth May has announced that she would like to see 40,000 Syrians allowed in Canada immediately, expediting the process as much as possible and using military transport to go and pick them up and get them out of this horrible situation that's causing problems throughout Europe, and bring them to Canada where we can welcome them with open arms. And that's exactly what the people have told us, that they're ready to help and they want to help. This is the greatest humanitarian issue that we faced in a generation, and we're doing far too little. Thank you.
This is an excellent and timely question, given the events, I was about to say recent events, but the events of the past number of years in Syria that we have not been paying enough attention to. Just this morning, our leader, Justin Trudeau, affirmed in Halifax his commitment to immediately bring in 25,000 refugees from Syria. In Nova Scotia, we are hungry for people, and oftentimes there's an attitude towards people who've gone through a horrific experience because they're from another part of the world, that they're going to bring some kind of trouble with them. And I think that's the wrong attitude, and I think if that's your approach, you're promoting racism within our province, which in my mind has always been open and inclusive and has made me proud to be Canadian. I learned recently, there was some news coverage, of course, over the recent Syrian refugee crisis. And it made me think back to an iconic photo from the Vietnam War, which is admittedly before my time. Some of you may remember it. There's a very young girl running unclothed away from the threat of napalm. What a lot of people don't know is that young girl was a refugee and moved to Canada. She is a physician practicing medicine in Whitby, Ontario, and has been contributing to her community in a positive way for decades. We need an attitude shift here. We need to welcome people here who've gone through the greatest humanitarian crisis that you can possibly imagine. And when we have a military role on the other side of the world and it ruins people's homes, we have a moral obligation to take those people here. So if someone shows up on the shores of Nova Scotia, I say welcome home. Thank you.
So with this refugee crisis, crisis. Canada originally brought in 20,000 Iraqi refugees. We've originally been bringing in 10,000 Syrian, and then several weeks before the issue popped up in the news the way it did, we had announced 10,000 additional. One thing we have to keep in mind here is there are millions of refugees, millions and millions of refugees, and this issue goes much broader than just that one issue. We also have to look at humanitarian aid. We've given millions upon millions of humanitarian aid. We must continue to do that. We also need to look at the military intervention that we're doing. The reason we're there, the reason we're doing this, ISIS is a real threat. They are a real threat to Canada and to the international community, and we need to be there. We're the only party that will continue to fight ISIS. The Liberals, the NDP, and the Greens have all said to withdraw. We cannot withdraw. We need to fight on with these guys. We must degrade and destroy ISIS. That needs to be a priority as well as the humanitarian aid and the refugees. We did announce yesterday that we would be looking at speeding up the process, but we still, of course, have to do security measures when we're bringing people in. We have to be prudent, and we have to be we have to make sure Canada's secure as well. It needs to be a focus that we have. Thank you.
This is something that I feel very passionate about, is about this issue of spending a lifetime in, as a service provider, being a police officer, serving the various communities and seeing people in desperate need. One only has to look at the images that are on TV and say that we have to do something. There's no question that Nova Scotia needs, we need immigrants. Without immigration, we're gonna die. Our population's aging at such a rapid pace. We're gonna take in 10,000 immediately, and then another 9,000, which is roughly 50,000 in the next 4 years, and we're gonna have an open ended for people to sponsor. So if somebody wants to sponsor the community, do that. But I wanna just shift a little bit away. If you drop a bomb on people, will you create a refugee? If you drop a bomb on a nation, will you create destruction? And do you have a moral and ethical responsibility to do something? Tom McIntyre and the NDP, and I personally feel somewhat different than dropping bombs, and that we want to take our soldiers back. We want to build our security internally in here. And I spent a lifetime, I worked on 9/11. I was there when the planes hit and had an active role on that matter. I'm not going to stand here and promote fear. We have to work together. We're a caring, loving community. We believe in people. Germany has taken 1 million. Canada can take 10,000, and we're worried about whether there's somebody's safety. Let's bring our soldiers home. Let's feed them property. Let's give them the security and help and broaden our internal security, enhance our policing agencies so that we can expedite those types of security checks that we need to do, and welcome people. Creating fear is something that's distasteful to me, and I'm going to stand right here and stand up against the Harbour government that's not acceptable. That's not who we are as Canadians. We believe in each other and we care for each other. And you might know that I'm a little worked up about that issue, because as a police officer and seeing people in the First Nations community or other people that are vulnerable times in our own community that need us right there. We know that our social services structures need to be worked on and we need to improve. So I stand before you, very proud of our party's position, and must bring people in. We are caring, loving people. And I just need to go around Nova Scotia and know that we will take people and welcome them, we will care, and we will be stronger. And we need to make sure that when we have the flag on the back of our knapsack, and many of you know what I mean if you want to go to travel in Europe, we were welcomed. Under the Harper regime, we have lost that. We need to bring that back to who we are and be a peaceful nation and restore our peace initiatives. Thank you.
Our final question for the afternoon deals with collaboration. We recognize that in order for smaller communities like ours to remain a vital part of this country, all three levels of government need to be involved. How will you encourage more collaboration with your colleagues at the municipal and provincial level?